now, right now. That's just an old black Negro spiritual. I love it. God is trying to tell you something. God is trying to tell you something. Maybe God is trying to tell you something. And maybe God is trying to tell you. Maybe God is trying to tell you. Maybe God is trying to tell you something. Work with me. Maybe God is trying to tell you something. 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 Well, Alan Mabry, can you sing? Well, can you play? Maybe God is trying to tell you something. He said he can't sing, but he can sure enough play. Yes, he can. So maybe God is trying to tell us something. Maybe God is trying to tell you. Maybe God is trying to tell you something. Tell me today, he's gonna tell me tonight. He might speak to me in the morning. But I know that I have ears to hear him. Do you have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church? Yes, Pastor, I have ears to hear what he's saying to me right now, and I'm gonna obey him when he speaks to me, and I'm gonna do what he tells me to do right now. I have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to me right now. When he speaks, I'm quick to obey him. I'm gonna do whatever the Lord tells me to do. Says go, and I'm not gonna stay. If he says stay still, I'm not gonna go. If he says get up, sit down, if he says run, jump around, I'm gonna do whatever the Lord tells. The Spirit is saying to me right now. I feel like I gotta dance with somebody. Can you hear it in the Spirit? Just how small the devil really is. We're gonna say, do you mean to tell me that this is what has been deceiving me? I feel like I'm embarrassed that I let such a measly little spirit get over me. When he's been defeated, Jesus took his keys from him. Set free by the blood of the Lamb. We're gonna catch another flow right here. Over in the Spirit, we're gonna live there forever and ever with I am. Everybody just kind of move a little bit. Sometimes you just have to free up. I know this seems strange, but in the realm of the Spirit, sometimes you just have to free up. Quit being so rigid. That other blues riff that we did the other day. Well, ain't no sense in trying to expect him to do anymore. Thank you. something? Satan was paralyzed on Calvary for you. Now the devil can only do what I allow him to do. Jesus said it is finished. Now the rest is up to me and you. You know, Jesus is sitting down. Somebody asked me recently, how's your walk with the Lord, brother? And I started to say, well, and out of my mouth came, I'm seated with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I thought, my walk with the Lord is a sitting. I'm sitting with him in heavenly places. I'm seated with him in Christ Jesus. That's that thing you were talking about resting. Finally, all the toil's gone. I'm just going to kick back. I'm going to be like him and wait for my enemies to be made my footstool. I like what Harold Lewis said to me one time. He said, I walked out one night, he said, moonlit night, looked like sunshine on the ground. Dark. He said, I said, Lord, you said heaven is your throne and the earth is your footstool. What's the moon? He said, the Lord spoke up and said, that's my night light. I think we need a fresh flow of joy. Some of us just need to learn to smile a little bit more. Who was it that said, I don't? About somebody and I don't like him, he ain't happy enough. I like that. If you ain't happy enough, don't hang around me, because I'm going to get happy. Say it, I'm happy enough.
I'm happy enough.
I'm happy too much. Those of you that have got a house, raise your hand. Those of you got a place to stay out of the rain, raise your hand. Now I think you ought to say, hallelujah, Jesus. A place to stay. I can hear it inside me. Oh, do you want to know what it takes to get God to move on your behalf? Just say thank you, Jesus. And rejoice in the Lord. He said, I said, rejoice. And again I say, rejoice. Lift your hands and be full of rejoicing. Thanksgiving towards Him. We're moving into Thanksgiving, aren't we? Let's don't wait till Thanksgiving Thursday to get thankful. Let's start getting thankful right now. Let's just go ahead and have Thanksgiving dinner. Will you fix me some Thanksgiving dinner? Let's just go ahead and have Thanksgiving. Oh, my belly's talking to me. Oh, my belly's talking to me. Oh, my goodness. Put the 91st Psalm up on the board. Psalm 91. You can start the recording right there. Have you been watching the news lately? I'd always heard that Ebola stayed over in those third world countries where human beings did despicable things and caused their bodies to get infected, and now they're spreading it all over. But now that things tried to come to America, did you know that when they brought folks over here to treat them, I told Janie then, I said, they've opened the door to that spirit. And it is a spirit. And we're going to take authority over that thing right here this morning. Amen. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High. Everybody look at me and say, Pastor. That's Jesus.
That's Jesus.
He is the secret place of the Most High.
He is the secret place of the Most High.
Shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. The deadly pestilence. Did you know what pestilence is? Pestilence is a deadly viral disease. It is a fatal epidemic disease. Janie and I went down to Savannah, Georgia. Thank God for the Hannahs. We went all the way to Savannah. Got down there and found out it's full of history. And they said in 1820, a yellow fever epidemic flowed through there and 1 in 10 died. 1 in 10. We went through all the old graveyards and a bunch of folks dead in 1820. 19-year-old kids, 20-year-old kids. Bunch of them. See, they were children that were born at about the time that the cotton gin was invented. And then cotton took off. Cotton boom took off. And so they started having kids. You know, prosperity will always make you have kids. It will. World War II, we did that. We got back from the war and people said, we've made war, now let's make love. That's what they did. If the war's over, let's have children. And post-war prosperity, and kids were born, and my parents had 3 kids before the war and a bunch after. And then I came along. Because I was the result of the 1958 recession. Dad was home. He's like, you know, boy, what nothing to do. So, you know, downtime can, and depressed times can cause you to have kids too. Be careful. But see, there was a great boom of prosperity in Savannah. And I mean people, the whole town was wealthy. Everybody was blessed. And there was this one family named Jones. And they were so wealthy, the whole bunch of them were so wealthy, they found a street, they named it Jones Street, and started building mansions. And I mean, and you could measure a person's wealth by the amount of iron gate they had, a wrought iron gate around their houses. And so the Joneses were putting big wrought iron gate around their houses as they built their mansions. And there were other people in the town that would try to put up wrought iron gate too. And they said the only reason they're doing that is try to keep up with the Joneses. And that's where that saying was coined, in Savannah, Georgia. Yeah. Big boom. And you know, with a big boom will come a mentality that says, we just do anything we want to do. You know, the roaring 20s were like that. Everybody was partying. Everybody was doing the Charleston. Well, that wasn't the Charleston, but you know what I mean. And then the downturn came. Was it? Okay. It's kind of a... See, Michael Jackson stole the Charleston, called it...
He just did it.
Yeah, he did. See, when prosperity hits you, oh my goodness, I hear the Spirit saying to me to prepare the people for prosperity. Hold on to what's good in prosperity rather than letting depression throw you to your knees. Sometimes in the height of prosperity, just drop to your knees and lift your hands and thank Him for the abundance of all things. My goodness. Thankful, thankful, thankful hearts receive more from Him. It doesn't matter. Imagine the wealthiest that you could ever be. It's still nothing to God. It's nothing to Him. He's paving streets with pure gold you can see through. That's what they drive on. See? From time to time in the Old Covenant, you'll find that blasting, mildew, pestilence swept God's people and took out. There was one time that 70,000 were killed at one time. And it was not the will of God. It was their lifestyle that did it. Hold your place there in Psalm 91 and go to 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles. Very familiar scripture. And you'll see some of what's going on. Second Chronicles, chapter 7. Verse 13 says, if I shut up heaven, that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. In the Old Covenant, it sounds to me like God sent this Ebola plague or this bubonic plague or whatever. No, there is, in the original Hebrew, there is a verb that says is a causative verb and an allowing verb. In this, he was saying, in reality, he was saying, if I allow this to take place, not send it. God don't have disease. He just allows it. If the people are doing things to where he's tied his hands. He said, but if they humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I'll hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin. I'll heal their land. Now, let me tell you something. He did that with Jesus when he sent him. Now, this thing called Ebola is a pestilence. It is a fatal epidemic disease. You'll find it in the curse of Deuteronomy chapter 28. Go to Deuteronomy 28 and look at verse 21. I'm going to show you this. The Lord will make, he said, this is the curse. And if you read all of Deuteronomy 28, you'll find the first 14 verses of Deuteronomy 28 are the blessings of the law. If you obey, if you do these things, this is the blessing that will come on you. Beginning in verse 15, but if you will not hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord your God to do His commandments and statutes which I've commanded you this day, all these curses will come on you and overtake you. And then the rest of the chapter is all about the curses. And look right here. Here's one of the curses. Say, one of the curses of the law.
One of the curses of the law.
The Lord shall make the pestilence. That is the fatal epidemic disease. Cleave unto you until he have consumed you from off the land whither you go to possess it. Now that's one of the curses. You remember swine flu? You ever heard of malaria? Yellow fever? We were talking about that in Savannah. Smallpox? Ebola? When that flu, what was that strain of flu that came out a few years ago called H1N1? Sounded like something. The bird flu, H1N1, sound like something on a Star Wars movie. R2-D2, C-3PO, H1N1. That's what it sounded like. Don't you be afraid of any of this. Don't you be afraid of Ebola. Don't you allow yourself to get caught up in the fear of that. It may be a physical substance, but it's got a spirit behind it. Our nation is calling for it. That's the shape we're in. Our nation is calling. The people of America are calling for that. Now, let me share with you what I mean. And let me just address something that you need to hear. You heard Brother Norville say this the other day. And listen, I'm not going to correct the elder in my life in any way. And just because he's Norville doesn't mean I agree with everything he says. But I agree with most things he says. Okay? Now, he said something that I've heard Pat Robertson say. He said that he believed that the reason why Katrina came over the top of New Orleans because they called themselves Sin City. Okay? Listen, I personally don't think God was the one that did it. I don't think he's destructive. Here's what I do believe. Do you remember when Jesus went out on the boat with the disciples and he was asleep in the back of the boat? And the storm came up and the boat filled up with water. But Jesus was on the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they woke him up and said, "Lord, don't you care? We perish." And Jesus got up and rebuked the winds and the sea. And there was a great calm. And he said, "Why were you so fearful? Oh, you have little faith." And the Bible says after he did that, immediately they were on the other side. So that storm was just off the coast. Then when they went into the city, after they landed aground, they went in and they met. What's the next thing that happened? You Bible scholars, tell me, what was the next thing they saw? They ran into the madman of Gadara, cutting himself and with stones and crying and living among the tombs, and he wore no clothes. He was totally demon-possessed. And he'd cry out. He'd cry and cut himself with stones. That storm, you know yourself that if strife breaks out in your house, it's just you'd rather be anywhere but in that house because it's just the feeling that's in the house. You know yourself, it's easy to make a mistake. And it's easy to wreck your car when you're in strife. Have you noticed how there's a spirit of confusion on strife? You ever noticed? I've seen people drive a car and as soon as they get in it, it'll break down. Because it seems like the spirit is on them. I can drive a car 100,000 miles, let somebody borrow it, it'll have two flat tires and the alternator go out. They did it. Fuel pump too. Yeah. You listen to me. That madman caused that storm that the disciples were in with his mouth. That storm came out of his spirit. If people cry out, if a city's wholly given over to voodoo and dark spirits, and they can cause a storm to come on them. It is the cry of America that's attracting this spirit, this thing called epidemic fatal disease. It's not God. It's men. It's the shape of men's spirits. Now, Psalm 91 again. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. I'm going by memory. Am I getting it? Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flies by day, nor for the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor for the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, and 10,000 by your right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Say it. It shall not come nigh me. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, There shall no evil befall thee, and neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. I'll say it, I'll not be afraid for the pestilence that walks in darkness. And no plague shall come near my dwelling. Now let me share with you what is going on. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1. There's always a key issue. And here is the key issue behind the Spirit. 2 Timothy chapter 1. Verse 7. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, the spirit of power, the spirit of love, and the spirit of a sound mind. Did you know a sound mind has a spirit behind it? Love has a spirit behind it. Power has a spirit behind it. So does fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. The spirit of fear is never God-initiated. You need to put that in your notes. God never uses fear to drive His people or to lead them. Now, we read this a couple of months ago, and I'm going to show it to you again here. Look in Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews 2. Y'all bring your Bibles with you? I don't hear one hard, but one or two pages turned. Man, you come to church and not bring your Bible? My goodness. Get you a hardbound print edition. Hard to write notes on that pad. Hebrews chapter 2. Verse 14, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, Jesus, He also Himself likewise took part of the same, that through death He might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Now here's what you need to know about fear. All fear, all of it, all fear has its root in the fear of death. All of it. It's because death in any form. And here's one thing you need to know about fear. All fear has torment to it. All fear is tormenting. Now, there's good news. Jesus Himself took part of the same flesh and blood so that through death He might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver them who through the fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Bondage comes through the fear, and bondage comes through fear of death. Job said in Job 3:25, you don't have to turn there, He said at the end of all that that went on with him, He said, that which I've greatly feared has come upon me. Write this in your notes. Fear is a magnet. Faith is a magnet. Fear draws to you what you are fearing. That's why you have to put it off. Declare war on fear. Now, look at 1 John. Go back to the book of Revelation and back up into 1 John chapter 4. Thank God we got a Bible, y'all. 1 John chapter 4. All right, now look at verse 18. Now read this with me. 1 John 4:18. Read this with me. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear has torment. He that fears is not made perfect in love. You know, you can get developed in love real quick. Read 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. Read 1 Corinthians chapter 13 in just a little bit. You'll be developed in love. It won't take long. You can do it by the afternoon. Don't take long. Do it before, right after you eat supper, right after you take a nap. Get up and get developed in fear. Get developed in love, not fear. Because see, we develop ourselves in fear.
Yes, every day.
Job said, "That which I've greatly feared has come upon me." He was developed in it. He'd even practiced it. I won't get into all that. Go get developed in love and do it before dark. Here's what happens. There'll be no fear in love. What kind of fear are you talking about, Pastor? The fears that we're all familiar with. Fear of tomorrow. Fear for sickness. Fear of not enough. Fear of lack. Fear for our children. Fear of some bad thing that happened in the past come on you again. Fear of your health, an unwarranted fear of God. Where the scripture says in that same chapter, Deuteronomy 28, one of the curses is in the morning, you'll say, "Would to God it was night." And then tonight you'll say, "I would to God it was morning." You don't even want to be where you because of fear. Fear will follow you like a little dog. It'll follow you around wherever you go. It'll follow you. Say, "Well, if I can just go over here and do this, I won't be afraid anymore." And only to find out that fear is right there. Have you seen those commercials about some kind of antidepressant drug? And it's a little cartoon commercial, and there's this little black cloud right beside it looking up at him. You see that? And he said, "After I've been taking this drug, I've been able to keep him controlled." And while he takes it, then that thing gets smaller, but every once in a while, it'll look at him. It's just like that. A spirit, a fear spirit, is a spirit. It's a real thing. And do you know what I know about fear? It never leaves. It has to be evicted. You have to run it off. There's a little dog up in Cave Spring. Every time I go up there, here she comes. Now, she's so fat, she looks like somebody inflated her. I mean, her skin is about to pop. I mean, and she wants something to eat. And I'll tell her, "Go home, Bonnie," and she'll look at me, thinking I'm going to give her something. "Go home. Go home." And when she don't go home, I go home! And she'll go. When you get serious, she'll go home. Boy, I was up there with Drew the other day, and Bonnie comes showing up because we just started the grill. Here she comes. She can smell it. And right behind her, Drew said, "Is that a wolf?" And I looked up the hill, and there was a gray fox looking at us. He smelled it, too. Now, I didn't have to run him off. He's got a natural fear of us. Say it. Perfect love casts out fear. Fear has torment. I hear this inside me. You know, in the scripture it talks about where Jesus said, okay, Lord, where he said that, made the distinction between a man that had fellow servants and one owed him 15 cents. Another, he owed him a great sum of money and he just forgave him. And then he went to his fellow servant that owed him 15 cents, and he would not, and took him by the throat and said, "Pay me what you owe." He said, have patience with me, I'll pay you all," which is exactly what he said to the Lord when he said he owed him a great sum beyond description. He said, "Have patience with me, I'll pay you all," and so he just forgave him. And then he went forgiven and went to his fellow servant and said, "Pay me what you owe." The scripture says that when the Lord of the servant was called and found out what happened, he said, "Deliver him to the tormentors Unforgiveness will put you in that spirit of torment because you attract a spirit of fear by unforgiveness. Now, I know there's some things that some people have had happen to them. It's just the hardest thing in the world to forgive. But it'll get rid of the spirit of fear off your life and put you in the love walk so quick. And perfect love will cast out fear. And there'll be no more torment. You know what? I believe, let me be broke and bankrupt, but with a peaceful mind and perfect health. Because a peaceful mind and perfect health leads you right into a place of prosperity. It is that right there that he said you prosper and be in health as your soul prospers. That soul prosperity comes when you've not holding anything against anybody. There's no war in your heart. You're at peace. There's no depression. Look at Isaiah chapter 54. We're getting ready to close up here this morning. Okay. Oh, yeah. Bring me that. You got that print?
Nobody's got it.
Oh, yeah. Okay, very good. I get that quote ready. I want you to see this. Isaiah 54. I love this scripture. He starts off by saying in verse 11, O thou afflicted, tossed with tempest and not comforted, not visited by the Holy Ghost yet, because the Holy Ghost is the comforter. He said, I'll lay your stones with fair colors and your foundations with sapphires and your windows of agates and your gates of carbuncles and all your borders of pleasant stones. Verse 13, everybody in here that's raising kids needs to know Isaiah 54:13. All thy children shall be taught of the Lord. And great shall be the peace of thy children. In righteousness shall you be established. You shall be far from oppression. That is that same depression spirit that you hear doctors talk. When did they start telling people, ask your doctor if our drug will be good for you? When did they start advertising to the end user to let them diagnose their situation and go talk to their doctor about it? Tell you, when the drug company goes right to the guy that's got the money, it ought to tell you what he's in it for. He said, thou shalt be far from oppression. Why? For thou shalt not fear, and you'll be far from terror, for it shall not come near thee. Verse 17 says, no weapon that's formed against you shall prosper. Every tongue that shall rise against you in judgment, you'll condemn. This is your inheritance as a servant of the Lord. And their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. I love that. Now, let me say this to you again. All fear is a fear of death. All fear has torment. All fear brings oppression. There is no such thing as healthy fear. Well, you know, I have a healthy fear about this. No, there's no such thing as a healthy fear. Well, Pastor, if you're not fearful about something, you're being irresponsible. There is no responsible fear. You're born with two fears, the fear of loud noises and the fear of heights. Everything else is taught. Believing the lies of the devil brings fear. Just like God's word brings faith, the devil's word brings fear. Fear and faith are opposite forces. Fear never goes away. You have to evict it. You have to run it off. Isaiah 59:9 is an interesting verse of Scripture. Put that up. Isaiah 59:9. I learned this early and it really did me good. You'll like this. He said, that's not the one. I thought I wrote it right. Isaiah 59. He says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord lifts up a standard against him. That is Isaiah 59:19. I'm sorry. Apologize for that. 19. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west and his glory from the rising of the sun. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, comma, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. Move the comma, because that was added by the translator. Move the comma from flood, when the enemy shall come in, comma. When the enemy shall come in. How does the enemy come in? Fear. The whole thing about this Ebola thing in our nation is a spirit of fear. And when he's come in, like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord lifts up a standard against him. Don't you allow yourself 1 second of fear about that spirit. In a minute, we're going to take authority over it. It will not come into Douglas County. We will not have a person out of this county down here at Emory University, in Emory Hospital. We are not going to have that. We're going to stop that right here. Don't you worry for you kids. Don't you worry about that. We're going to stop this right here. I was watching it on television the other day, now there are these people in Dallas, Texas that have got it, and they're bleaching the insides of these apartments and all that stuff. These folks look like, they kind of remind you of the people that were on the moon, walking around in their suits. And I said, Lord, that don't scare me. He says, uh-huh. Yeah, but I got a bunch of folk that are scared of it, and I want you to deal with it. That's what he said to me. Yep, you're right, but I got some people that I want you to deal with this. Now, I want you to look at something here in Deuteronomy chapter 28, once again. All such pestilence is listed under the curse of the law. We saw that in Deuteronomy 28 and verse 21. Now, look at Deuteronomy 28 and verse 61. In case you're concerned that this is going to be a problem. Nobody, the word Ebola is not in the Bible. But Deuteronomy 28:61 describes it. It says, every sickness and every plague which is not written in the book of this law, them will the Lord bring upon you till you be destroyed. Now that is the curse of the law. Under the old covenant, you had to totally obey to have the blessing. In fact, that's the way the blessing and the curse of the law was established as a double motivator. If you obey, you get all these blessings. If you disobey, you get all these curses. And still nobody could obey it. The curse of the law is written from Deuteronomy 28, verse 15 to the end of the chapter. And you'll find it. Name it. Anything that can possibly happen. Separation, divorce, your children going into bondage, disease coming on you, lose debt. Did you know debt is under the curse? Now, I want you to turn with me. Say this to me. Pastor, Deuteronomy 28 shows me the curse. Now, look in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 13. Very simple. Very simple. Tell me when you're there. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. See, we don't realize what redemption did. Jesus himself became divorce on the cross. He became sin on the cross. He became sickness and disease on the cross. He became sin. You want to know what sin looks like? Look at what Jesus looked like on the cross when it was all on him, when you couldn't recognize who he was or what he looked like. He became Ebola. Say it with me. He became Ebola.
He became Ebola.
He became the bubonic plague.
He became the bubonic plague.
Did you know that if those folks in Savannah had known that the yellow fever was born on the cross already, they could have broke the power of it right then? You know, I was shocked. I was shocked to find out that poison ivy and poison oak was a spirit. When I was a kid, I helped a lady next door to my sister clean her yard. And it was in the hot summertime, and I was helping her pull vines and stuff. She said, Johnny, that might be poison ivy. I said, I'll help you. I was wanting to help her. Got it all cleaned up. And let me tell you something. That junk broke out all over me. You may remember it. I'm talking about these big scabs came out on my legs, and I mean they broke loose and oozed and ran down my legs, and they got on my hands, and I rubbed my face, and before I knew it, my face was swollen, and it was up in my nostrils, and it broke loose inside my nostrils, and my nose would run inside with the ooze, and it itched so bad I wanted to take a wire brush and scrape my face, and I looked like a monster. The neighborhood kids didn't know who I was. Who are you? And it came back the next year. And it came back the next year. It came back for 6 or 7 years in a row. Terrible, terrible. Then I found out it had a spirit behind it. I was in my 20s when a man said to me, "Oh, you can take authority over that spirit that's on poison ivy and rebuke that thing." He said, "Then you can get to where your body will develop resistance to it and won't bother you." I said, "Well, I wish I had known that." What is it that causes God's people to be destroyed?
Lack of knowledge.
I didn't know. And I suffered with that. Terrible. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, "Cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive this promise of the Spirit through faith." Go back to Psalm 91, we're going to go home. Yeah, I want you to see this quote. Put that quote up here. There's a man that used to be the White House chief of staff under President Obama, and then he left to become the mayor of Chicago. I guess he knew he was going to get elected. You reckon they fixed those elections? He made a statement that ought to interest us. He said, "Never let a serious crisis go to waste." And what I mean by that is it's an opportunity to do things you think you couldn't do before. See, if we, the people, allow the government, to put us in fear, and the government do, they can manipulate you. Fear manipulates people because you'll do things in fear that you wouldn't do any other way. And you can let people manipulate you. People put you in fear. I know pastors that have put their people in fear. God in heaven, don't let me ever answer to the Lord Jesus having put my people in fear when I was called to put them in faith. Because you can make a person your subject. There is a scripture in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. It says, he's talked about these people, said, "While they promised them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought into bondage." Psalm 91, and let's close up right here. I can tell you this, there's some churches that need this a lot worse than y'all do. I know Christians that need this worse than y'all do. I tell you, y'all impress me with your faith. Y'all do. But I know fear is sneaky, and I'd rather have you in advance have addressed this before you need it. Didn't Jesus say that? He said, "When I tell you these things, when the day comes that this comes, you'll know that I told you this ahead of time." He said, "You're not going to be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flies by day," verse 6, "nor for the pestilent that walks in darkness, nor for the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 will fall at your side, and 10,000 by your right hand, but it'll not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you behold and see the reward of the wicked." Now, understand, this Ebola thing may take over on somebody. It might get a hold of some people. It might get a hold of some folks that are unborn again. It might get a hold of some Christians that don't know what I'm telling you. But you could stop it right in its tracks right in front of you. You can. "No evil shall befall you, neither shall any plague come near your dwelling." Say it again. No plague is coming near my house.
No plague is coming near my house.
4025 Westview Street is not, it's off limits. It's quarantined. I like this right here, verse 14. "He has set His love upon me, because He set His love on me." There it is again, the love walk. "Therefore will I deliver Him.
I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Let me make sure I'm done because it's noon and we got to go. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Somebody quote Galatians 3:13 to me. Say it. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. Say it again. Jesus Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law, being made a curse for me. Therefore it is written, is everyone that hangs on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham may come on the Gentiles. That's me, through Jesus Christ. Say it. The curse of Deuteronomy 28 has been put on Jesus. Ebola has been put on him. It cannot come nigh me. Now here's our job, y'all. We are the ones that know this. Do you know how many people in our county right now are gripped in fear over what they're watching on television? You know how many?
Lots.
Most of them. So we're going to do them all a favor, even if they don't even know it. Get this ready to go. Here's what we're going to do. I'm not saying this thing don't exist. I'm saying that don't believe the news media. They'll blow it up out of proportion because it's easier to manipulate people. Do you think maybe, just possibly, that your government might use this plague to force you to not allow any of your congressmen to ever repeal Obamacare? You think it might be used for a political purpose to draw? You think so? Okay. It's called fear. I want you free. I don't want you ever to feel like you're bound by any political person. You're not bound by Pastor John. You're bound by nobody but Jesus himself. And he that becomes the Lord's bondman becomes the Lord's free man. You're free in Christ Jesus. You're not bound by anything. Not bound in fear. Not bound by worry about tomorrow. Not bound by worry over your kids. Not bound by worry or fear or frustration or depression or oppression. You're far from those things. I want you free from it. Say it, I'm free from it. Now let's all stand. We're going to do this for the county. We're responsible for this county right here. And we're going to stay. And hey, if you want to do it for the city of Atlanta, that's fine. Raise your right hand. Just say this with me. Spirit of fear, I come against you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
I come against you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
No plague shall come near our dwelling.
No plague shall come near our dwelling.
Infectious disease. And the spirit back of it. Go from here. Douglas County is off limits to you.
Douglas County is off limits to you.
Ebola, go!
Ebola, go!
Now that's the way that works. That's the way that works. And it's that simple. Before this week's out, you're going to start hearing people talk. Oh, no, you got to be careful about that. Oh, Ebola might get you. When I was a kid, we saw a movie. I was a little boy called Tabunga. And he was a tree that would come to life. And I'd watch it. And all these indigent people and all the natives were there. And it was like this. And I'd watch it. And then you start hearing boom, 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 boom. boom, boom. As soon as they start hearing that, oh, God, it's Tabunga. And I go to hide behind Mama. And I was scared. I'd watch. I couldn't get my eyes off the television. And couldn't stand to watch it either. And it put a fear in me. I mean, it put a fear that Tabunga. Boom, 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 boom. And all the natives would go, it's Tabunga. Oh, boom, 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 boom. There are people right now in this county, yeah. Ebola. Oh, Ebola. There are people that believe, and it'll draw it right to them. It's amazing how the very thing you don't want is, if it was to break out in Atlanta, they'd go down there and wouldn't be able to keep from it. Get down there and get in it. Fear will drive you right to the thing you don't want. Anybody want to go broke? Don't get afraid of it. Anybody want sick? Don't start being afraid of it. Ain't but one way to change it. Got to get over in faith. Jesus himself took my infirmities, bore my sicknesses, carried my diseases, and by his stripes I am healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned every one of us to his own way, but the Lord has already laid on him the iniquity of all of us. Yes. He became Ebola. He became lack. He became sickness and disease. He redeemed me. Jesus has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Right, go look at, this is your homework assignment for tonight. Deuteronomy 28, verse 15 to the end of the chapter. And look at all you've been redeemed from.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for joining us today for the Word Wise Christian broadcast here at Church on the Word. We're glad you joined us today. Remember, God gave us this written word to get our thinking straightened out. When our mindset becomes the mind of the Lord, peace settles in. That's when our confession gets straightened out, because our thinking is straightened out, our believing gets straightened out, and that's when we become
word wise.
God bless you. See you next week. Jay Alexander, if you'll close us up in prayer. Oh, is that the one? Just say no to Ebola.
Let's all lift our hands. Father, we thank you for this service this morning. We thank you for your faith in our lives, that we can have faith in every aspect of our lives, including our physical health. We're going to have faith in this area. We're not going to have fear. We're going to walk out in faith and minister faith to everyone we come into contact with. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name, we thank you for this service and for an excellent service next week. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. We'll see you next week.
Speak to me.